She's sitting there doing the switches. Wicka, 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 wick. We are now in the third episode of How to Use AML Services. This is obviously an overview, a quick overview. There's tons of other stuff. We can only cover so much. We want to make sure that as data scientists, we know the capabilities that we have in AML. We've looked at an overview. We've looked at setup. We've also looked at using Workbench to do data preparation and how we actually hook that up and how we actually make some transformations, et cetera. And then we got started into actually using notebooks in this case. Let's dive into a little bit more of like how you would actually train a model, and then there's this notion of context that I want you to get into. Why don't you tell us about that?
Okay, perfect. So whenever you are training a model, you would want to probably use the most powerful compute so that the training is faster, mm-hmm. but at the same time you want to control the cost. So you cannot just bring in any compute. So what we provide you, it's like you can bring in your own compute and attach it to the data server. So basically the notebook server can now use a remote compute over there. Now, any data scientist would probably need certain libraries in order to actually start. Like say in our case, the example which we, or the application which we are building is for income prediction. Mm-hmm. I'm using Scikit-Learn and matplotlib for visualizing stuff and Seaborn and things like that. So because we start with a data science virtual machine, which is a standard data science virtual machine, we probably want to tell it that, okay, I'm going to use these libraries. So it's just one line of code, and we just tell that, okay, install these libraries if they are not available already.
I see. So just to be clear, when you're running Jupyter Notebooks, there's this notion of a kernel.
Yes.
And you're saying that we can actually target remote machines as the kernel to run on.
Yes.
But we need to tell that remote machine, hey, you need to have these things in order to work.
Yes.
Okay, so show us how you do that.
Okay, perfect. So in the previous episode, we already created a data science virtual machine and we provided the username, password, and things like that. So what we do is essentially just attach that particular remote machine. And this is a simple command. It's just one line command that you would use. And here, essentially, I'm telling my machine learning. Okay, so, but let me actually show you how do you type it over here,
yeah.
Right? So, yeah. So, you have, you already have your project which is there in the machine learning workbench. You go to the file menu and you can select open command prompt.
I see. And so that's what surfaces all those AZML commands.
That's
that we
right.
Want to use.
Yeah. So we pre-install all the stuff for you, and the once you have that, the only thing you have to do is log into your subscription and you are started.
Perfect.
Okay. So I've already done that, and it's essentially talking to my application right now. It's in the same project directory. So when I say that, okay, attach a compute, it knows where to attach it. So it attaches it to that particular project which is there.
I see. And I'm guessing that it creates some JSON file or some file that says, here's where this we need, whenever we want to run this particular kernel, this is what we're talking about.
Yes, and I can show you that. So essentially, because we are heavily based on Docker now, because we heard that, okay, Docker is the industry standard now, right? So we containerize everything in Docker. So in fact, in the machine learning workbench, we have something called files, where you can see all the folder structure and all your assets. Mm-hmm. So in that, we have something called AML config. And in that, you have a file which gets generated, which is there, which is Conda dependencies. Mm-hmm. Now in this, because as I mentioned earlier, I am using three custom libraries. So once you run that command and attach it, we have this Conda dependencies file. Now in this case, initially when you have the file, you will not see any custom libraries. But because I know that I'm going to use these three libraries, I install these libraries and make it available for my DSVM, which is there.
I see. So let me see if I understand. So we first have to tell AML here, there is a remote machine that we're going to be using. That remote machine then creates a Docker container to run these things in.
Yes.
And then it says, okay, when you create that container, make sure I have these three things in that container when I'm training.
Perfect.
Okay.
That's
okay.
Right.
Yeah. Awesome. So you, in this case, if you have a very powerful DSVM that you've set up on Azure, you could be running a couple, 5, 6, 7, 8 containers training all at the same time.
That's right.
Because I've seen some with up to 4 GPUs, so
yes.
That means that you can have 4 of these things running at once, on a separate GPU as
yes,
well.
Yes, yes. And okay. and just like DSVM, you can actually even have other computes like HD Insight Spark, and the process would be similar.
I see. Okay, that's cool.
Yeah. So we have this file. Now, I'll just close this. So once we have that thing set up, we just do a start notebook server. And when you start the notebook server, it will ask you which particular compute you want to use. Now, in this case, we are using the remote compute. And because I loaded the experiment earlier, it actually started with this. So here, if you see, this is my DSVM, which we have.
I see. And so, like, even if you have like a really garbage machine, if you have the power of the cloud behind you, you're able to actually run some pretty powerful experiments with just using your machine as sort of the dummy interface.
That's right. Yeah.
Okay. Thank Fantastic.
You, yes. And just to emphasize, like, okay, you can change the kernel. So here, I had my local machine. So if anytime I want to switch the kernel to my local machine or a local Docker, I can do that as well.
Fantastic.
And if I have multiple machines, then they will just show up over here.
All right, and so in this case now, we're going to be creating a model to do the prediction, and you chose Scikit-Learn.
Yes.
Why don't you walk us through a little bit of how you set it up?
Yeah.
Obviously, that's secondary because we want to know more about the service, but why don't you give us a quick overview of how you would go about writing this here?
Okay. So in this case, I'm first just initializing the Azure ML logger. Mm-hmm. Now, this service, it's essentially helping you maintain all that run history and all the nice things we talked about the service.
I see.
So every run gets logged in, and you can go back in history, look at the output, and things
oh,
like
I
that.
Oh, I see. So if I'm, for example, changing my learning rate from 0.1 to 1, just to see what the difference is,
yeah.
I log that using the Azure ML logging, and then when I go back into the experimentation service and see my runs, there'll be an output there that says, yeah, you change it from this to this, and then the accuracy or the recall or precision change from this to this.
That's right.
Okay,
yeah,
cool.
Yeah. So then what we do is we import the libraries, which is what you would do in any machine learning experiment. This is where I bring in my data. So in this case, you can see that my data is actually stored in an Azure blob. And because we provide libraries, I can just import it right away.
I see. So this is actually working on the real full data set, not just a little bit of data rows that you got.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. And the next step is actually I start to look at the data. And as you remember in our previous section, it's just visualizing the data. Mm-hmm. So it's the same data set. I do some transformations. So in this case, I'm just replacing, because my column had some dot, I'm just replacing it with underscore. And
so let me see if we're being clear. You could this is you doing it yourself, or you could have used that
data
conversion file that we saw in the last visual
That's
video,
right.
And that just generates code for you.
Yes.
Okay.
So you cannot see the code, but we give you the final output, which you can actually scale it out. So you just tell your DSVM or the HD Insight cluster, wherever you want, that my input is this, and this is what I want the output, and we take care of everything in the.
I see, and that's what that dprep file is going to do. But here, we decided to just show you the other way to do it yourself.
That's right.
Okay,
yeah,
cool.
Yeah. And then, because I'm using logistic regression or things like that, they expect numeric. I'm just mapping the strings to actually numbers. So this function is just a mapping function in order to map it. So like, say, a gender, like male or female, I'm mapping it to 0 or 1,
okay.
Things like that. The next part is I'm just, like, there are some cells which do not have a good value. So
yeah.
I'm just replacing it, the nulls, with a random number. In this case, I chose a negative so that my model can essentially ignore it and not use it during training. Then once I have done all the transformations and replacements, I again visualize my data. And then I create features. Now, in this case, because I know that, okay, there are certain fields which can impact the income of the field, I'm picking those features right away. Uh-huh. But in your case, like, you will have to do a lot more experimentation.
The sciencing part.
Yeah.
The sciencey part.
Right, yeah.
People don't realize that science means glorified guess and check. People don't realize. That's what it is, right? But here, because we want to show the services, we go straight to the heart.
That's right. So I have picked like 16 features right now based on that. And then the income based on those features is what we are trying to predict, which is the label in this case.
Cool.
Okay. So then I start with the actual modeling. So here I'm importing the Scikit-Learn related libraries and methods. And then I just do some standard procedures or steps where I'm telling the logistic regression model that, okay, this is my input data, these are the features, and this is my label, which is the output. Go ahead and train and figure it out, like, okay, what's the model, so that when I give you some new data set, then you are able to.
So effectively, like my experience is machine learning is you pick a certain algorithm that generates a certain kind of model, you pick the way to optimize it, and then you say, go optimize.
That's right.
And that's what we see here,
yes,
right? You're using grid search to optimize a logistic regression model.
That's right.
Okay,
cool.
Yeah.
So once I have the model created, I'm just actually looking at the accuracy. So in this case, I'm getting an accuracy of 84%.
Okay.
Now whether
which is okay.
Yeah. We can do better. Mm-hmm. Sure. So I'm looking at some more metrics, and then like we said, we can improve. So let's use another machine learning model. So in this case, probably we'll use random forest classifier.
Okay.
And you could use something else, but I just chose mm-hmm. to use this. And we again repeat the same approach that tell it that these are the features. This is what I'm trying to predict, and then it gives us voila accuracy of 87%.
That's a little bit better.
Yeah,
nice.
and even the testing data set gave us 86% accuracy. Cool. So then we have the model, so I think we are happy with this. Mm-hmm. So let's go ahead and deploy it.
Fantastic. Okay, so just to be clear, we talked a little bit about how to actually run the notebook inside of a different context with a different kernel on a different machine, how to specify the requirements for that particular machine, or I guess the container inside of that machine.
Yes.
And then we did some experiments, and then we finally decided, hey, we're happy with this. Now we need to talk about how to package it.
Yeah.
And oh, we also, and I failed to mention, we talked about the logger and how we can use the Azure ML logger to actually make the experiments more powerful. Can you show us a little bit about the run history? That's one thing that I want to see what it looks like.
Sure. So on the left-hand side, you see this tab, which is, we call it runs, and here you have all the runs from your past. So let's say in this case, whatever run we have right now, it actually tells you how much time it took and whatever output I'm giving and things like that. And then you can do, you can go inside and actually see all the outputs which are available. And there is, you can compare different models, and then you can even use Git, like if you want to
sure.
store it.
And this is where all of those values that I output to the log would show up, so that I can really look at stuff.
That's right.
Really well.
And even the debug part of it. So essentially, if your experiment is not performing well or you hit up on an error, we show all the logs over here as well.
I see. Okay, that's
important.
Amazing.
Yeah.
So the last thing we're going to talk about, and we'll separate that into another video, is how to actually take this model that you built, because we decided that the decision forest is going to be the best one. We got to find a way to package it and put it out so people can use it.
Perfect.
We'll leave that for the next video.
Yeah.